Hi everybody, good afternoon. I am sure all of you are looking forward to listen to Amod. As people are joining, maybe I'll give some introduction to the team. So my name is Bhumesh and I graduated in 2005 from IIT Kharagpur. I was in Patel Hall and I studied electronics. And last 15 years I've been in Bangalore. So this is my short introduction. So before we get started, I would like to tell you guys about the team behind who's making it happen. So that you know how the whole thing came together. So maybe let me give you an introduction about KGP Stack. So KGP Stack is an initiative from, of course, KGP alumni, and they are most of our senior batches. I would be naming them as I'm just waiting for all of them to be there. So this was this KGP Stack stands for KGP Startup Connect. So what happened? I got connected with Kimi and the team recently, and they were saying, why don't we help our young entrepreneurs with the experience of our experienced entrepreneurs from Kharagpur. And that's how this whole initiative came. And so Kimi is from 91 batch. Hanumant is from 92, Hanuman Shukla. Then Anand Anupam, he's from 2002. And Ramji Ganti is from 2003. And I'm from 2005. So this is the team. We also have our alumni backing us up because without them, it won't happen. So we have our sponsor, Affine Analytics. It is again from Kharagpur, founded by Manas Agarwal. And this is a leading enterprise analytics consulting firm working with more than 500 Fortune 500 global enterprise across US, UK, Europe, APAC. Okay, so this is about our sponsor. So that you guys know who is behind this, okay? As we do more of this, I'm sure you will get chance to interact with the rest of the team. But today I am here to talk to Amod. And what I can tell you is I am very excited. I'm very nervous because first time you meet a KGP senior, you are generally nervous no matter where you meet, whether it's a Zoom call or you meet them in a canteen in your second year, right? So my feeling is the same, but you know what? I'm sure most of the entrepreneurs are looking forward to take some nuggets from Amod, but I'm personally excited because I get to talk to my senior from Kharagpur. That is one reason. And second is I've been personally been a fan or a follower of Amod, but never met him before this. So I am excited about knowing about Amod and what he has been doing. So without any delay, let me welcome Amod here. Hi, Amod. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you perfectly. Hello, everyone.
So Amod, I'm excited and very, very keen to talk to you. I'm sure we'll get into the nuggets and the deep stuff about what you know for the entrepreneurs. But you know what? Many of us are interested in your journey. And journey is if you look at our last poster, right? I'm sure you're not watching all the publicity which we are doing, right? But the last poster was about a small town guy from Shakti Nagar, right?
Yeah.
Most of us didn't even know the name of the place. Coming and creating a unicorn is itself a journey. So more than anything, we would like to know the personal side of you. Maybe something about your place and maybe school and then obviously KGP stuff for sure.
Sure. I grew up in a place called Shakti Nagar. It's a small town. Fairly removed from all cities. I think the nearest city would be Varanasi, which is 225 kilometers away from that place. So that's a fairly that town used to be the power capital of India. I don't know if it still is or not. There's a cluster of power stations in that area. My father was an electrical engineer, so he used to work at NTPC. So that's where I grew up. I think pretty much did all of my schooling in that town. Then straight out of school, I went to Kharagpur. So that was in 1998. So in our place, it used to be a big deal to get into IIT. So I was, you know, basking in all the glory that came with it. After that, it became fairly routine. So yeah, I think, so once I landed in KJP, that was my first major time away from my hometown. So because I had not spent any time in these coaching classes, so you know, I was never really out of home. So you know, it was fairly interesting learning curve, but you know, found a bunch of friends there in the first week. So you know, that sort of pulled up my spirits. Then spent a great 4 years at KGP, three out of which were in Patel Hall. First year, as you know, actually is a common year. So you know, hall mate, and you should be knowing that my name is there in the hall. What do we call that? That board where I, you know, sort of won some awards for the hall and stuff. So immediately after KGP, so I graduated in 2002. That was not a good year to graduate job-wise. So the job market was just about recovering from the great crash of, you know, the dot-com bubble burst that happened. But I was lucky that I was one of the few whose company did not retract their offer. So I was very thankful and grateful for it. That company was I2 Technologies. So I spent the first 2 years in that company. It was a supply chain technology company, fairly large for my taste, I would say. Little after coming into it, I started looking out for a job because I just felt that I was not doing anything. Like I said, the job market wasn't great. So in 2004, finally, I joined a startup. Startups of that time were very different from startups of now. There was much less glamour associated with it. That startup was called ITLX Technologies. Us samay pe there used to be this technology called Web Services. Some of the older ones in this group would remember. So we were creating a product in it. So spent 2 years there. That didn't go anywhere. Then joined a company called Like.com. Which was eventually acquired by Google. Joined a startup called Apna Paisa to create their engineering team. A little after joining that company, there was this financial market crash that happened of 2008. So that, I think, you know, sort of killed the prospects of that company. We were about to become parents, so left that company, came back to Bangalore, and joined Flipkart. So that was in early 2010, that startup, you know, had a very different trajectory than all of my previous startups put together. So you know, found some success there. Then in mid 2015, left Flipkart because you know, I'd spent a fairly rigorous 5.5 years there. decided to take a break, spend some time, then got together with two of my other ex-Flipkart colleagues, and we started Rodan, which was into the B2B e-commerce space. So that's the introduction.
Okay, so that's very short introduction, but I'll take you back to Patel Hall because I have some memories. I entered Patel Hall in 2002. So it means you moved out and I was entering. There was some interesting thing happened that year, it looks like, or the previous year, right? Patel, between Patel and LLR.
Yeah.
Let me tell you this, the rest of the KGP stack committee member, most of them are LLR guys. So that's why I'm hiding still more.
Yeah.
I have muted them so they can't talk much. All the fun we will have actually. But yeah, most of the guys are LLR guys, and Patel, I think this Patel LLR thing happened, right?
Yeah.
So you have
it was
any
a very stupid thing that happened actually. I think I don't know why it happened. I was there when it happened, and I was like, you know, pulling the legs of my friends there. Ki dekho kya mazak ho raha hai, ek dusre ko gali denge and chale jayenge. But things turned a lot worse. And I think there were a lot of lessons learned after that for everybody. Yeah.
In fact, maybe I'll talk to you personally to get the details, because even I don't know what exactly happened.
Sure.
You'll know much better.
Yeah. I can give you first hand account, but this is not the right forum for it.
This is not the right forum, because I need to stay in this committee. Otherwise, they'll throw me out of BGP's track. You will have a new host for the next week, actually.
And I don't think you will face any issues. Interestingly, LLR used to have the best mess at the time. Just a week or 10 days after that incident, people were back to going to LLR's mess. So I think, we shouldn't read into it any more than what it was.
Good for covering up, Amod, for me.
Sure.
Nice. So Amod, obviously, we know, you know, a lot about you, because okay, you are a public figure now. People read about you. One thing personal maybe you would want to talk about is, how did you get inspiration? Because this is your back-to-back startups, right? Obviously, not all of them do well. But I think from 2004 onwards, looks like, I think you have been in startups, right? And first two or three did not go anywhere, right?
Yeah.
As compared to what is happening right now. So where was your inspiration coming from?
And that's a good question, Bhumesh. Personally for me, I have always liked building, right? I mean, that's where I derive my gratification. And, there's plenty of that to do in a startup. Of course, there were these, remarks from my father every single time. Case bar bhi Infosys nahi join kiye, kyun nahi join kiye? But I think eventually, he understood ki ladka haath se nikal gaya hai. Personally for me, it was never a big deal. I think it's a matter of taste, I suppose. I find a lot more joy in just building something. And that's how it is. Now reflecting back, it looks like ki theek hai, struggle ki hai and, something good happened. But to be very honest, it didn't feel like struggle at the time. Obviously, there used to be like these moments when thoda financial crisis ho jati thi. But I think some or the other way, it would sort of get managed. It was ultimately, IT degree ka point kya hai, if you can't have, if you can't have the confidence ki in the worst come worst case, you would be able to manage somehow. So I suppose ki I didn't really feel like struggling as much at the time. I actually had a lot of fun, a lot of really, really smart people. Yes, failures were there. For some reason, at that time, it didn't feel much. At least I don't have memory of being particularly sad or something. I just loved the fact that, we built great stuff, a lot of which was, really, really appreciated by people. Yes, a financial success would have been like immensely welcome, but I don't think I have any struggling or bad memories about the time.
Very good point, Amod. Actually, aapne bahut acha baat bola. People say, yaar, IIT degree ka fayda kya hai? The main advantage we have is this. Any point of time, we try our hands on different things. We have this confidence ki job to mil jayega wapis jayega.
I think he ultimately was source of confidence. I was discussing with somebody, some KGP, source of confidence kahan se, and I realized ki apne KGP ke jo profs hai na, khas karke jo, I don't know about the other departments as much, but electrical mein jo profs the, I think if you can survive the 4 years there, I think wo confidence naturally aa jata hai.
So do you recommend that that electrical department prepares you फॉर अ टफर वर्ल्ड आउटसाइड.
यू नो, हर किसी को अपने डिपार्टमेंट के बारे में वही लगता है भूमेश. आई फील कि मैथ डिपार्टमेंट फोक्स वुड एंड अप शेयरिंग द नोट वेरी सिमिलरली इफ नॉट मोर. सो या
Great. So I would love to know more. I'm sure people are very interested in knowing about your personal life. But I have a lot of questions which have been coming for last 1 week, and we have tried putting them into some category so that they get answered automatically,
sure.
Not quite like one-on-one question. Towards the end, we would definitely have some time to ask for some questions which people are asking us on the screen. So first category of questions which have been coming to us is related to funding, and I'm sure it is okay. So it is very, very interesting. But you know what? Most of the people are asking. I'll give you a background. Most of the people are asking when is a good time to think about funding. Okay, obviously, and the second is obviously how, which I'm sure you would not want to answer in detail. But second is how. Third is I think which is related question, so I would want to put in same category, is the equity distribution, right? What do you give to investor? What do you give to founders? How do you manage ESOPs? So most of the questions are related to that. So it'll be nice to talk about, you know, when you were starting, let's say you can take example of Udaan, because you might remember most of what you did in the beginning, the initial journey. When you start, how do you think about funding? I'm sure some of our money will go first in. Some of us have better finances because we have done few startups before, but many of them not, right? When do you go for funding? And obviously a little bit of about the process, if not the minute details.
Sure. So lots of questions in there. Let me give a broad-based perspective. But before that, I'd like to caveat pretty much all of my statements by saying that I think Udaan's learning in terms of funding wouldn't be a great example, because I don't think that's the norm. Okay. We were fresh out of Flipkart success, and I think there's a lot of benefit that we ended up gaining because of it. I think our fundraising process would actually not be reflective for most of the folks. Heck, like before Flipkart, if I would have tried raising money, my journey would have been very similar as well. And I think so that's something to bear in mind. So I actually should not be the best person at just sort of sharing advice on it, but I'll still share my thoughts. But you know, please bear this in mind. I think in terms of timing, there is a particular statement that at one point in time, I think I first heard from Sachin, or if I remember correctly, that Sachin at Flipkart, that, you know, the best time to raise money is when you can. When you have whatever factor working for you, it could be market sentiment, it could be a lot of liquidity in the market, in the VC community, it could be, you know, a product market fit that has just happened for you. It could be that, you know, there just is particular sector mein, there's a lot of money coming in. Any factor, if you feel that you will end up needing money, you should raise money when there's a high chance of it converting. You shouldn't wait for the time that you will need that money. If you know that you will end up needing the money, you should try to raise for it at the best time. Time should be, the best time is measured in terms of the probability of conversion, not in terms of what you feel is when you would be needing it the most, right? In terms of, that said, not all companies actually need money. I think there's a good trend that we see of startups which can actually develop a fairly good customer base purely on bootstrap money. And there are a lot of such examples. In particular, in the past, I've talked a lot about how productivity per engineer, a productivity per builder, or productivity per employee is the highest ever than it has been, you know, as compared to the past, right? So bearing that in mind, there are plenty of such examples right now where people have gone ahead, bootstrapped, created something that is genuinely useful, and people used the money, the revenue from their customers to expand it out. So there's a lot of such work that is happening in gaming that has happened in in a lot of sectors that has actually happened. I think a few exceptions would be jahan par ki there's a lot of infrastructure that needs to be created. E-commerce is one of those where you typically need to, and in a country like India, there's a lot that you need to invest in infrastructure in order to actually make e-commerce work. Another would be, say, for example, if you're setting up a bank or something like that, or if you are setting up a supply chain company, right? Anything that requires significant investment, there obviously you need to raise a lot of money. But I would say that for a lot of other sectors, fundraising should be, you should be thoughtful about why you are raising, right? And if you know that you need it, then time it based on the chances of conversion, I would say. What would also be very helpful is to remember what increases the chances, right? See, we as entrepreneurs, we often end up getting over invested in our idea, end up thinking isse badi idea to life mein aise hua nahi hai, right? But there is it helps to understand it from the perspective of the other person, the person who you are talking to in order to raise money. It could be an angel investor, it could be a VC. I think we need to think about one of the following factors matching up. Again, this is an answer, this is a question that is best answered by a VC, but my thoughts are as a angel investor, that either it needs to be a sector match in terms of how an investor is thinking about that sector or that domain. The investor has enough intuition that they are able to match your intuition, match you at an intuition level, okay? Or there needs to be a product market fit match, okay? Where the investor may not have as much intuition as you, but you are able to get them to that level by virtue of proving that product market fit. Okay, look at this data. These many customers are using my product in such and such way. These are my engagement or growth or whatever metric you feel is best suited to represent your product market fit. So either that happens, or there's a team match, which is that you go to the investor saying, ki, dekho, this is the rockstar team that we have. I may not be able to explain things completely to you, or you may not be able to understand it completely, but is team pe to tumhe confidence hona chahiye. Team dekh karke anybody would be able to get a sense ki pata nahi kya banega but kuch acha banega. Right, so I think one of the three has to match. And it's when thinking about approaching investors, it is very helpful to really put yourself in their shoes, ki assuming that this is the first time that you were hearing this idea, how would you react? Okay, so yeah, I think that's another thing that I feel helps a lot, but with surprisingly few people end up thinking about where in their fundraise. Yeah,
nice. I have one question related to it. So let's say you said raise whenever you can, whenever possible, right? Yeah. So most of the people are not able to get to this valuation thing. They think my valuation is X right now, let me take it to Y, then I will raise. So how do you balance that? Because maybe it's too late by the time you reach by.
Yeah, valuation. I don't think there is any objective measure of it. The only objective measure of it is the market. Is the open market, right? So even there, it's a very subjective thing. Sentiment ke basis pe even rock solid capability wali company ke bhi valuations in the public market go down. Just because some news about somebody actually got spread, right? So I don't think we should think too objectively. Like, there is no real math behind valuation. Personally, I feel yes, there are these formulas etc. that people end up using, like future some future cash discounted workflow, not workflow, something like that exists, right? My co-founder Vaibhav talks about it a lot. I think
convertible notes, basically convertible notes which you can give it some
instrument, I think DCF I think
okay
yeah ke bare mein wo like I hear about some of these terms but my, in my practical experience there's not been much like the general market doesn't react to a lot of math behind valuation right so you should think in terms of what is best for you and you should obviously it's in your interest to put the best foot forward I generally prefer that you know entrepreneurs be very open and honest about things without trying to compensate by trying to overcompensate for being honest right so sometimes what happens is people overrepresent these shortcomings right because you are in the thick of things so you understand the shortcomings just way too deeply and there's also this complex that goes on in entrepreneurs often enough where they don't their confidence about something keeps on going through a sinusoidal curve right so it's very important to be honest about the reality of things about what is the positive and what are the potential risks but like we must bring out the best foot forward right the best possible picture while being open and honest about the risks as well that's another thing I think another element of this is great storytelling which I think I wish a lot more engineers were exposed to I think you know we as engineers tend in particular engineers tend to get way too worked up by maths of things I think there's a great storytelling aspect to fundraising which is very helpful
so I understood the second and third one very well can you elaborate on the first one the how do you connect with investor on an intuition level
on the intuition level see intuition level is ab jaise ki say for example there are these investors who end up say for example you were doing something in the let's pick a buzzword if you're doing something in the blockchain space right you would want to be talking to a Naval right you would want to be talking to a Naval and you know a bunch of other investors who end up talking a lot about that space because that's when you wouldn't be wasting time explaining the possibilities because these people are you know in the domain themselves enough that they are continuously trying to imagine the possibilities so you even if you are not able to articulate it in precise terms there is an intuition level connect that happens okay so it's a lot more about a selection criteria that you're running with ki for the domain that I'm actually doing business in these are the kind of investors who would be able to connect with me at an intuition level okay you can't make somebody develop intuition right you can over time that happens but while fundraising there's not enough time to actually develop somebody's intuition all you can do is reach out to those who are far more likely to be sharing the same intuition so that's what I meant by the domain
all right got it so thank you we have a little less time I know we have kept 1 hour for your time I have little more information related to the same topic it is very you know personal to your current you know organization Udaan so in this whole structuring thing how do you know talk to your founders give them equity and you know how do you kind of you know resolve conflict how did you put a structure because we know that formally I think Udaan does not have a formal CEO right so how does investor look at it that is one part second is how did you communicate with your team because you have put a structure which has worked otherwise it won't reach here right so
yeah.
Can you talk a little bit about that
yeah I think so there were two or three questions baked into that one in terms of starting out how do we think about equity split etc the three of us put in equal money so you know we you know starting out we actually shared that you know the company equity equally between us obviously we set aside a fairly large amount for as ESOP for the team that actually took a bet with us people who took a great risk and joined Udaan in its early stages we continue to keep that ESOP component quite high because we ended up creating a fair amount of wealth for ourselves because of Flipkart's ESOPs. So we understand the value of, we understood the value of ESOPs. And that's the reason why, you know, at the beginning as well as, you know, right now, we continue to be very, sort of having a fairly largish ESOP pool. And between us, obviously, we continue to own equal shares, you know, based on whatever the investors haven't touched yet. In terms of the structuring inside the organization, e-commerce actually requires three very distinct flavors. And that's one of the reasons why we started Udaan together. One is you actually need to have fairly strong technology orientation because e-commerce is a lot more than just making a shop online, right? That's often the mistake that people think, I think there's a lot more to technology in e-commerce than that. You need very strong operation sense. You need, you know, in terms of on a day to, because your real, your touch point with real world is happening on a very continuous basis, on a very large scale, be it in terms of supplier pickups, be it in terms of handling returns, be it in terms of your supply chain, be it in terms of actually routing payments. So because of that, you need to have very strong operations rigor. So that's the second component. Third component is that you need to have a very strong intuition of where the market lies today and where the market is headed to. Okay. And all three components actually need to come together in order to make e-commerce work. And that's the one reason why the three of us, you know, sort of found the concept of B2B commerce very, very lucrative. Because it played to the strength of the three of us. And that then translated into how we actually structured ourselves internally. So a lot of, for example, market development pieces about which category we enter, which category has how much margin, and what should be our play in that category. A lot of these things are looked after by Vaibhav, who actually has very strong intuition about these areas. Sujit, who has got, you know, I feel like he's the best supply chain sort of mind in the country right now. He brings in a lot of rigor around our, not just our supply chain operation, but overall operations at Udaan. And a lot of technology and product development is something that I end up spending a lot of my time on. Like what kind of a product would make sense for us for the next 2 years or 3 years and stuff like that. So, and that's how we end up sort of splitting up our responsibilities. All strategic calls the three of us end up making together, how it translates into each one of these three areas is something that we then, you know, sort of are completely free to figure out between us. Just give me a sec, there's rain coming in.
Sure.
Yeah, sorry, that was Bangalore. right, so in terms of interaction, depending upon the nature of topic, we end up having a discussion. So let's say, for example, if it's about studying or planning how supply chain areas should look like, Sujit ends up taking the lead. And, you know, so based on the topic, we end up picking up different leads, I would say. So that's how we are set up.
Oh, that's why I never felt you have to kind of structure it and one guy kind of becoming a, like a CEO phase or whatever.
So there are times when we've talked about it, to be honest. In particular, jab koi bahut bhayankar conflict ho jata hai hum log ke beech mein, and you know, we end up fighting it out. Us samay lagta hai ki nahi yaar, ab to jo hai decide karna hi padega. But I think it eventually sort of settles down. I think part of the thing is there are certain cons to having a particular person as a lead, you know, things that we have actually witnessed in the past. I think there may be a time when the need for having a single person actually makes a lot more sense. But abhi tak to gaadi chal rahi hai aage.
Okay, so then I will go into the your domain now, which is technology, right? You were in Flipkart. Obviously, there was a big scale technology team there. Obviously, you scaled very, very fast there, right? Same thing, I think, with Udaan, right? So a lot of people who are not able to do it have these questions, right? How would you scale such a large technology team? Because it's not easy, right? For most of the people, it's not been happening. So some lights on that.
So the simple answer is you don't have to. Why do you feel you need to scale out technology? And in fact, at Flipkart, I feel one of my biggest regrets is that I scaled out technology way too quickly. I think over time, you can actually build it out. But I actually feel quality ends up mattering a lot more. Okay. So, and at Udaan, just to clarify, we actually, until about 9 months back, we actually had a fairly, I would say, very small technology. We recently crossed 100 engineers just, I think, about 4 or 5 months back. Okay, so at this, or the same scale of business at Flipkart, if I remember, we had around 800 to 900 engineers. So I think you can actually do a lot with much lesser engineers, I feel. It's very different from, you know, 10 years back or 20 years back, okay, when just there was such less open source ecosystem that almost every single thing actually used to be built in house. Aaj ke din mein, you literally, you know, don't, other than your core value prop, uske alawa aur kisi cheez pe focus karne ki zarurat nahi hai, literally. So, you know, for service fabric, you've got, you know, a bunch of things along with Kubernetes. You know, you don't have to, app building is just super duper easy. React Native ke upar mein karne pe, you end up building out Android plus iOS plus whatever, you know, kind of other things actually come up. So there's just so much ease to building products now, in particular internet products. Even in the hardware space, if you have to think about the Arduinos of the world, like they've changed how people actually think about that space. So the cost of coming up with something useful is actually much lesser than what it used to be. And it's actually coming down dramatically. And which is why we actually need builders. We actually don't need a lot of what I refer to as code monkeys or something like that. You need people who are excited about solving that problem. Because if they are, a single person or a few can actually move mountains. Instagram, when it was acquired, like how much? I think 20 odd people that they had. I think same with WhatsApp.
Yeah.
So it's a myth that you actually need just tons and tons of engineers. It's something that I see particularly in the Indian ecosystem. Sometimes even the investor community, they're like, you know, matlab, how do you manage it? And I think I feel ki, you know, it's just something that's very unique to the Indian ecosystem. You know, bhar lo. Growth means a lot of people, yes. And I think there are times when it is meaningful. But a lot of times it is not meaningful. When people are chasing growth without thinking through, as an engineer yourself, I mean, and I'm presuming most of the audience is also, you know, engineers, at least somewhere in the background. It's a myth that two engineers would be able to produce double the work, right? There are some kinds of job profiles, just a salesman. You want double the, business, you double the sales force or something like that. But it doesn't work like that when you're building. You know, when you're building a capability, if you're thinking, ki, you know, if I had 100 engineers, I would be producing 100x the output. It doesn't work like that. And I see that this fact is missed the most by people who have not built a lot of things themselves. I think quality ends up trumping quantity any day. Doesn't mean that, you know, you need to be like super duper small and you shouldn't hire. You should absolutely hire. But, you know, quality pe zyada dhyan dena chahiye than ki are mere paas itne engineers hone chahiye.
So, how's your typical day now? Because I know you have been a techie, right? All this while. So, has something changed? How's your day now? Are you
I
coding?
still build. I still build. Not just coding, but there's hardware stuff that I keep on playing around with. So yeah, I think I like building. So that's my favorite pastime. That's how I relax.
Okay. So, maybe one of the last technical question about growth. I'm sure VCs have, they the way they have they look at companies, right? When you grow from, let's say, X to 10X, right? How do you balance between, let's say, scale and quality? Because VC will say, okay, grow from here to here in next 1 year, but you know, right, how to balance probably between a quality and scale. Most of
Yeah,
the
I
companies
think,
are not able to do it, basically.
see, it's very hard to give a formula to that, right? Because every situation is unique. So, you know, what looks like, yeah, this person should have better managed, this balance in the past may actually be key that person was doing the best that they can. I think it's difficult to give a formula to this. All I would say is key, the only thing that I can say is that there is no formula. I have seen people over-index on capability building. I will create the brightest and shiniest thing and then actually approach the market. Tab tak market hi badal chuka hai. So I've seen that happen. Likewise, I've seen people on the other extreme key growth, 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 and capability ghanta. And that ends up crashing down as well. I think the answer obviously is somewhere in between, but how you like where is that balance is not just dependent on where your comforts lie. It also depends upon the time. Say, for example, if in general you are running with slightly more over index on capability building as against growth, but a competition comes up. For the next 6 months, you may actually need to be focused a little more on growth at all costs. Okay, so I think that's the difference between that's one reason why philosophical discussions around this topic make far lesser sense. Far more useful is just observing how different companies have reacted to it. The only thing is what looks right in the immediate moment may look disastrous 5 years later. And there's been a ton of companies like that, right? I wouldn't name the investor, but there are a few investors, who have invested in companies which have been known for rapid growth only to come crashing down because they didn't have any capability whatsoever. I think yeah, the answer is very unique to every situation, I think.
I
Sorry,
agree.
I sorry that I don't have a precise answer for it, but I truly believe that there isn't a precise answer.
No. I totally agree, and I'm just asking so that at least people get some idea, and people don't beat me up later. कि मेरा क्वेश्चन तो तुमने पूछा ही नहीं.
That's fair enough.
So we are almost towards the end. Maybe one last thing before we open it to the questions. Now the pandemic situation. Currently, some industries are doing well, some of them are impacted more, and some are impacted less. What where do you see, I'm sure you are researching about growth areas, you have your own interest also. So do you think this is a good time to be an entrepreneur, or एक जो जॉब लेके थोड़े दिन 1 साल निकाल लो, फिर मार्केट पिकअप हो जाएगा, देन यू ट्राई योर हैंड्स?
I think this is a great time. I think any time is a great time actually to start out. But times जिस समय पे there's a lot of churn that is happening, right? Like behavior shaping churn is very hard to come by. These things happen when something disastrous happens. So जैसे कि फॉर एग्जांपल द फाइनेंशियल क्रैश के बाद में अ होल बंच ऑफ द फाइनेंस इंडस्ट्री वेंट थ्रू अ ह्यूज चर्न, राइट? अ लॉट ऑफ ग्रेट एंटरप्रेन्योर्स एक्चुअली इमर्ज्ड from that time. Likewise, some of the best in known internet companies of today actually started out just around the time that the dot-com bubble had burst, right? So I think this is a great time because it's almost like ki loha garam hai, right? Okay, because everything is just so much churn, you have the ability to influence people's behavior. Like who would have thought ki working from home would become such a norm? Like who would have thought? Right, कि जहां पर इवन क्लासिकल इंडस्ट्रीज आर नाउ थिंकिंग अबाउट इट एज कि अरे ये तो कंप्लीटली नॉर्मल है, राइट? So at moments like these, there's a significant sort of opportunity to shape people's behavior. It's like the demonetization moment ke baad mein jis tarike se Paytm ka growth hua tha, right? Because you know the timing was right. People's behavior was actually susceptible to change. So this is one of those moments, and I feel ki you know, people should definitely capitalize on it if they feel that they have a good idea. If you don't feel like you have a good idea, then obviously no.
Okay, thank you, Amod. I would request everybody who is on the Zoom call and the YouTube live session, please type your questions, and I think we'll give 15 minutes for your questions. Please put it here and the comment section on YouTube. So meanwhile, I would talk about our partner. So Amod, I was talking about, you know, our sponsor is a KGP alumni. We have our partners, Manish Bhandari. They run a company called GrowthPal. They have a data and intelligence-driven recommendation engine for acquisitions, strategic engagement, and fundraise. They have data on the enterprise universe of startup investors and strategic corporates and use algorithms to give personalized recommendations. Looks like most of the questions which people are asking, maybe they can get answer here. Because I think they are, yeah. So they are all, two of the co-founders are from KGP. So Manish Bhandari, I ended up talking to him sometime back on a similar setup, maybe a few months back. So if you guys want to connect with them, you can connect if you have more questions about merger acquisitions, things like
that.
Yeah,
I think they sound like the right set of people to actually.
Yeah, looks like whatever we are trying to, you know, bring together, I think they might have a, you know, intelligent answer, pointed answer for them actually.
Yeah.
Okay, so one question which the host has before, because I don't want to miss my chance. How do you manage to stay so fit?
How do I manage to stay so fit? I don't know. No, I just, I'm not as big of a foodie, is all I would say.
ऐसे पीछे मुझे दिख रहा है कुछ maybe
that हाथी के दांत खाने के और दिखाने के और वाला वाली स्थिति है
but no it's visible also that you stay very fit. Is it workout, exercise or diet?
I think diet ends up playing a larger role for me, but it's not like I sacrifice anything. I just am not a foodie. That is all that plays in my favor. Yeah.
Okay. So I didn't want to, you know, miss my question. So I'm done with my question. I'll ask what others are asking. Would you consider bringing a CEO from outside like Google did?
Professional CEO is what they are called.
Correct.
I think so there may be a time where that would actually be right. Abhi to hum log kafi strong builder phase mein hain. To is type ke phase mein I think it's probably best for the founders to be, you know, leading the charge. But I think eventually though, you know, there is some goodness that is brought out by, you know, professional CEOs. So there could be a possibility for it at some point in future. I don't know. But it's not something that's top of mind for us at all. Yeah.
Okay. Personally, which are the growth areas you are looking at? Let's say, do you have interest in investing? Do you do angel investing? People want to know what is your personal interest these days.
My personal interests are also linked with building. There is some of the other thing that I keep building on my personal side. Investment, etc. I end up doing a little more opportunistically. I don't actively seek investments. So, and which also means that incoming investment discussions ka bar, I keep it fairly high. So yeah, it ends up, I do not end up spending a lot of my time in investment discussions. That's not something. Usme jo, like a small part of it, like 5% of those discussions are very, very meaningful. And, you know, I love having that, but 95% is not as exciting. And that ratio is not like very, I'm not very comfortable with it. Which is one reason why I don't think I'll ever be a VC. But yeah, I mean, so my time is spent far more in building things.
Okay. So how do you define career paths for people who are coming to join your startup at early stages?
career paths for people. I think that's a good question. I actually end up feeling I avoid defining career paths in terms of levels, like, you know, iske baad tum ye ho jaoge ya ye ho jaoge, etc. I end up thinking about it far more in terms of ki, what is the opportunity that you have to build? What is the canvas that you have? What is the landscape that you're working with? And if you succeed, what does it look like for you 3 years down the line or 4 years down the line? Okay, both in terms of wealth as well as in terms of your decision-making skills. Your decision-making skills, your builder skills, just so that's how I tend to articulate career paths to people when I'm looking to bring them into Udaan.
Okay, so I'll call out name. Thanks, Prashant, for that question. How do you know if we are executing in the right direction?
Your customers will be telling you so.
Yeah. I think this got answered. How do you find co-founders? I think you explained it very well, that you need to know what is the need of your business.
Yeah.
Okay, great. So maybe we'll take last one or two questions. Vipul has a question. What are some of your early decision choices from early Udaan journey that didn't work very well?
That's a good question. I think let me talk about two. One is that where we thought that a lot of the ecosystem that is required to make e-commerce work, because B2C ka itna success already ho chuka tha, we thought that the same ecosystem would be leverageable in B2B, jaise supply chain ecosystem ho ya credit ecosystem ho. And so initially we built out the platform assuming ki assemble third party services ko we'll end up using. Okay, so we tied up with a bunch of modern age NBFCs, which the fintech companies, so to say, and some supply chain, modern supply chain companies. And we realized that their offering at such a core level, it was tuned to B2C that it wouldn't work for B2B. So it was a learning curve that we went through, and we had to change our platform to sort of make some of those things work. Then another decision was the speed at which, just like Flipkart ke time pe, I think, I ended up over hiring. At Udaan, there was a time when we were under hiring. So, we actually ended up keeping, I've talked about this in two different places, both of the same forum, Future of Work karke ek forum hai. Jisme ki in their inaugural one, I had called out how some of the choices that I've made. And in the next such talk, I ended up talking about what mistakes I made in those choices. So in terms of product engineer, software engineer, and stuff like that. So, I think it's a bit too detailed to be sharing it out in a very small one sentence way. So I recommend people actually go through it. In particular, the second one, because I summarize my first one as well as call out what were some of the mistakes and what are some of the changes that I then did in order to make up for those mistakes.
Okay, so we have a question from Kimi. In what way your earlier startups helped you in building Udaan?
I think in many, many, many different ways. It's difficult for me to, I don't think about it, but so I can't nail them down precisely. But every single element of who I am has been shaped by the journey that I've gone through. And such is the case with everybody, right? So the way that I make decisions, the way that I think about failures, the way that I think about success, the way that I think about people who are with me on this journey, every single thing has been shaped by my journey. I recommend to people, very, very strongly that be a part of journey where you get a lot of opportunity to create. And that's one thing which, if there's one thing that I would like people to take away from any of my discussions is just build. The more you build, I think it shapes, you may see success, you may see a lot of failure, doesn't matter. It shapes you it refines you like gold, man. I mean, the intuition ends up getting built by your failures, isn't it?
Yeah. So what are the companies, again, Kimi is asking, what are the companies you admire for engineering?
I think there are plenty. Say for example, I think, is the question around in particular around India?
I don't know. They're saying just what are the companies that you admire for their engineering?
It's a very one-dimensional question, where in reality, there's a lot of different dimensions to it. Say, for example, there are very small boutique companies, where people have actually done some fantastic work. I think DeepMind is one of them. That's less engineering, more about their AI pieces. So there are those, a lot of such small boutique. Some of the best work that actually gets done is in those boutique places. But in terms of the larger companies, I would say Google obviously is actually one that is immensely respected. In case of, at Flipkart, I believe that there are teams that are just immensely talented. There are also teams which sort of, are a little more on the average side, but there are teams that are immensely talented. Then, I think I'd leave it at those two. Obviously, I'm immensely proud of the, but I don't think that would have been an answer that would satisfy people who apna dhol bajane wali baat hai.
Yeah, so we have only 3 minutes. We'll take last few questions. So name is not written, it is written Pixel 3A. So that's the ID which is given here. How do you judge and hire people for leadership roles who are way more experienced?
Who are way more experienced? That's a good question. I think starting point is to not get overwhelmed by a person's experience and to actually use this as an opportunity to get a flavor of the experience that a person brings to the table. So in general, I tend to have a lot more like P2P discussion, peer-to-peer discussion. And there are times when people have been very generous with their thought process and very kind and very forthcoming in terms of mistakes and what they've done. There are times when people end up coming across a little ki matlab ye to tum jis school ke bachche ho us school mein master tha wala type ki cheez, right? So I think there are times when I've sent a fairly experienced person as an intern to actually interview some experienced people to actually evaluate it. I think it's very important that people at irrespective of the experience end up focusing on it, like being very clear about who they are, what value do they bring, etc., and not being bothered too much by years of experience and stuff. I don't know if it helped, but those are the thoughts that come to mind immediately.
Thank you. It definitely helps. Dharmendra has a question. Do you think entrepreneurship can be part-time effort, considering that some of us need to continue in our job for some time?
I don't think it works part-time. You can say that, there's something that you're building. There's a difference between building versus being an entrepreneur. I think you can still be a builder part-time, but I don't think you can be an entrepreneur part-time. It's a full-time, all-consuming thing.
Okay, so last one, which channels, Vipul has asked this, which channels your best early hires come from?
Direct network.
Your own basically network.
Yeah.
Great. So I have instruction from my seniors that we have to finish on time. So we started on time. We are finishing on time. Thank you, Amod. Really excited. I'm glad we talked today. I'm just super excited to know your background. Maybe next time I go to Patel Hall, I'm sure I'm going to look at your names. I'm glad you didn't ask me this question. Ki tum batao kahan kahan mera naam tha. Main phans jata. Waise bhi time khatam ho gaya. Toh ab toh aap bhi puchh nahi paoge mujhse kuch.
Good to hear, Bhumesh. Good to be talking to you, Bhumesh. Thank you so much. And thank you, the whole stack team. And I wish everybody the very best.
Thank you. Okay. So everybody who was here, I have some announcements. Thank you, Amod, again. Thank you, the audience, people who are sponsors and partners. audience, I would want you guys to be part of KGP Stack group on LinkedIn, because the goal of these events is that we are able to help younger entrepreneurs. So we need to be at a platform where we can exchange all the ideas. So please go and be part of the group. Thanks to all the alumni who are supporting us. We are talking to Anish Reddy next week. So we will be announcing, very soon about, how you can be part of it. People who have already registered on the platform, they don't need to register again and again. We just wanted you to be part of the LinkedIn group and the Telegram channel. We'll keep updating you all the information there about what we are going to do next. All the updates related to what we are doing will be coming there. And thank you, everybody. And we are done. See you next week at the same time on Saturday.